So I would like to end the first segment of trigonometry before we move on to trigonometric equations now with some useful formulae. So these formulae, once again, I won't be deriving because slightly less on time, but I'll be actually telling you how they have come so that you can sit down and do it as an exercise for yourself. So this first formula, which is basically sum of angles in AP, or rather sum of sine of angles in AP. So your angles alpha, alpha plus beta, alpha plus 2 beta, so on up to alpha plus n minus 1 beta, these angles are all in AP. How do I find the sum of the sines of these, right? So the formula for that is this, right? Sometimes in exams, few questions here and there come from this particular thing. So it's not very difficult. What you simply have to do is just take these two, find the transformation using the transformation formula, convert this sum into product, right? Then in the product, you'll have two terms. Out of that, one term will be very common to this. So you'll take the, you know, you'll just club these two, use transformation formula, and then, you know, club these two, like this thing and this entire thing, and then use transformation formula. Like that, you'll keep doing it until you use the last term. So if you keep applying transformation formula again and again, you'll finally come to this particular thing, right? So this is what our formula for the sum of sines of angles in AP is. Likewise, you can also have cos of angles, right? If you replace alpha with pi by 2 minus alpha, your sine will become cos, right? So the sine alpha will become cos alpha. The sine alpha plus beta, you'll have something else, right? You'll have a cos term. In fact, you can also write pi by 2 plus alpha, right? That won't make a difference. In fact, that's better. So if you do pi by 2 plus alpha, sine alpha plus pi by 2 will be actually cos alpha, right? And the second term that you're seeing, sine alpha plus pi by 2 plus beta, this will become cos alpha plus beta, right? Because, and you'll have a plus sign everywhere because sine in the second quadrant is positive, right? So supplementary and complementary formula, that's something that you've already seen. So you already know how to do that. So from this itself, you can also get the formula for the cos of angles. Just replace alpha plus, just replace your alpha with alpha plus pi by 2. And in the final formula also, you'll do the same thing. Replace your alpha with alpha plus pi by 2. You'll get the formula for the cos, sum of the cos of the angles in AP, right? Coming to the next thing, these three formulas that you're seeing here, they are all valid when this condition holds good. So these are what I would say, they are your conditional identities. These are valid only if your sum of the angles is 180 degree, right? Or basically, you could say they are valid only if your angles are the angles of a triangle. If ABC are angles of a triangle, then A plus B plus C will be 180 only, or pi in radians, right? 180 in degrees and pi in radians. And only if this condition holds good, these three formulas will hold good, right? And how do you derive any of these? Just using transformation formula. So for instance, if I pick the second one up, so these are slightly important. In fact, previously in JE Advanced, or basically IIT JE in that time, subjective questions of maybe 1 or 2 marks, they used to come from this particular topic. So if you have this, If you can, it's very much visible here. You have a sum here on LHS, you have a product here on RHS. That means sum to product. How do you do that? Once again, you do that using a transformation formula, right? Only transformation can make that happen. So sine C plus sine D is, you know, the formula for this, 2 sine C plus D by 2 cos C minus D by 2, right? That is what you will do here. So you will club these two, apply transformation formula to these, and also, There will be steps in the middle in the derivation where you will use this particular identity. So something like whenever you have a plus b, you'll replace your a plus b with pi minus c. And sometimes if you have c, you'll replace c with pi minus a plus b, right? That'll all come in the derivation. When you read, you'll understand. So using transformation and using this identity, I can always transform this sum to this product, right? So if you want, you can remember it. And in case you forget, there's no issue. You can just practice once deriving it yourself using the transformation formula once, and you'll be good to go, right? So that's what the conditional identity is as far as these particular terms are concerned, these three formulas, right? So you have a few more, but with how it goes with trigonometry is there are so many formulas, you can just keep going. What you actually need to practice is how to derive these, right? That is the reason why, that is the actual challenge. Once you practice how to derive these, you won't actually have to sit and memorize any of these, right? But these final three, they are slightly important, right? These three are also not very important. So in fact, this is slightly less important, this is more important, and this is actually very important, the last three, right? Because deriving the last three is also you won't use transformation for these, because they're already in the product form. So if you were to use transformation, you would use it only when you have to, you know, either convert product to sum or when you have to convert sum to product, right? Only then you will use formulas like these. But as you can see here, you have three terms, and the product of these three terms is simplified to one term. And you can see here, there is some 3 theta here. So instead of actually using the transformation formula, what you'll be using here is the basically your multiple and submultiple angles formula, right? That is what you'll be using. So in fact, you have cos 60 minus theta, cos 60 plus theta. So this can be written as cos square 60 minus sine square theta, right? So cos A plus B into cos A minus B. The formula for this is cos square A minus sine square B. So what you will do is you'll club these two. You'll let your A equal to 60, you'll let your B equal to theta, right? And use that particular identity. And then finally take the cos theta term common, you'll also have to use in one particular step, the final step, you have to use the formula for cos theta to prove that LHS, cos 3 theta to prove that LHS is equal to RHS. So all this I'm just, you know, narrating the derivation to you rather. So it's only to give you an idea that, okay, this is the way you need to proceed. So whenever you look at the textbook, you'll be able to see those steps yourself, and nothing will help, frankly. Not me deriving it, nor you reading the textbook will help it. You have to take your pen, you have to take your paper, and all of these identities, whatever you want to remember, you have to derive it yourself, right? So that you get the confidence that, okay, even if you end up forgetting the formula, you can always derive it yourself during the examination, right? And some of the formulas which you won't have the time to derive, in the examination, and a question is actually guaranteed from that topic, you have to practice that particular formula in so many questions that it actually comes to your hand, right? So that's how it goes with trigonometry, right? There's not a lot of concept, there's not a lot of effort that I can put from my side, and it's more of required from your side as far as all these derivations are concerned. Let's move on to trigonometric equations now.